Hi there. I've realised there are a lot of misconceptions out there about photography file types, and so over the course of the next two videos, I'm going to cover everything you need to know about different photography file types, as well as the things that people never really tell you, but they should. And so in this first video, I'm going to concentrate on the RAW file, and in the next video, I'll cover everything else. So what is a RAW file? Well, it might surprise you to know that a RAW file isn't a photo. It isn't even a single format. It's a name for a collection of different formats that are used to capture unprocessed image data. Now, remember that phrase, unprocessed image data. We're going to come back to it a lot. So there are lots of different file formats that are classed as RAW files. Most of them are proprietary formats of the camera manufacturers, but some of them are by software developers, and no two formats are the same. So unless you're very new to photography, you'll know that the reason we use RAW files for our photos is the latitude it gives us to edit photos. They are more editable than most other formats. But here are some other important things for you to know. So if a RAW file isn't a photo, how do you view it? Well, the answer is that you actually can't view it. Despite what people like me say when we stick an image on the screen and say, here is our RAW file, it's not actually our RAW file. What you're looking at is a RAW file conversion, and that is an important thing to note. Remember that a RAW file is just unprocessed image data. So when you import a RAW file into your photo editing software, it's converting that unprocessed image data into something that you can look at, but that is not your RAW file. But you need the RAW file conversion in order to be able to edit with it. Now, I say edit with it rather than edit it, because you can't actually edit a RAW file directly. Remember, RAW files are just unprocessed image data. And like no two RAW file formats are the same, no two RAW file conversions are the same. So to understand this, you need to know a little bit about how your camera's sensor works. In your sensor, there is a grid of what is called photosites. Effectively, photosites are the pickup points or detectors for light and color information. In our final image, we talk about pixels, but pixels don't occur until that data becomes an image. So on your camera sensor, each of those points is called a photosite. So each photosite corresponds to a pixel in the image. And in order to understand the color information for each pixel, it uses a color filter. So there are lots of different types of filters, but the main two used in consumer cameras are Bayer filters and X-trans filters. Now, both of these filters use red, green, and blue to filter out colors. So we'll start with the Bayer filter. There are a layer of red filters that only allow red light to pass through them, and these are applied to a quarter of the photosites. There's also a layer of blue that picks up a quarter, and a layer of green that applies to two out of every four photosites. So you end up with a grid like this. Now, that means you end up with some missing colour information, because you've only picked up a quarter of the reds, a quarter of the blues, and half of the greens. So if photo editing software used purely the colour information captured in the RAW file, your photo would look like a mosaic made up of reds, greens, and blues. So the software has to apply an algorithm to work out the missing information, and that's called the demosaicing algorithm. So for each red part of the mosaic, it uses the adjacent greens and blues to work out the missing green and blue information. And likewise, for the missing blues, it uses the adjacent reds and greens. And for the missing greens, it uses the adjacent reds and blues. So I've said before in videos that no RAW file is ever an accurate representation of what you saw with your eyes. And it's for this very good reason, because the software that you're using in order to be able to convert that RAW file and view it is having to work out some information. There's some computational algorithms that are happening here to work out some of the information that your sensor couldn't capture. So the camera manufacturers know perfectly well how their sensors and raw files work. But the software developers don't, and generally the camera manufacturers don't share that information with the software developers. There is one exception to that that I'll come to, but the software developers have to reverse engineer things to work out what the algorithm, the demosaicing algorithm, should be for each type of sensor. So sometimes when a new camera with a new type of sensor comes along, that sensor isn't automatically supported straight away, and the software manufacturers will be catching up to get used to what that sensor does. But the exception to that is Fujifilm and Capture One. So you'll often find that Fujifilm photographers will say Adobe doesn't work very well for Fujifilm files. And the reason is that Fujifilm uses a different type of sensor called an X-Trans sensor. And Adobe has never really gotten its head around how X-Trans work. But Fujifilm works with Capture One and they share that information. So Capture One has all of the information they need to decide on the perfect demosaicing algorithm for Fujifilm cameras. So X-Trans filters use a slightly different colour array to get the colour information for their files, and it's a bit more complex than the Bayer filter. Now, both methods have their advantages and disadvantages. And many people will tell you that straight out of camera, Fujifilm's RAW files look slightly more green than the same photo taken with a different camera and sensor. And it's for this reason that the X-Trans filter picks up information in a different way and the demosaicing algorithms use that information in a slightly different way. So coming back to the reason why no two RAW file conversions are the same is because each software developer has to work out their own demosaicing algorithms, and they all do them slightly differently. So to demonstrate this, I've got a single RAW file that I will convert using different pieces of software and show you what they look like. So here you're looking at a simple photo of a swallow on a wire with some white fluffy clouds and blue sky in the background. Really simple shot. And you're looking at it in Sony Image Editor, which is the native software that you get free with Sony cameras. So this should be as close to the RAW file as close can be. But what I'm now going to do is take that photo over and look at it in Lightroom. So here you can see it in Lightroom, and you can tell automatically that that picture looks quite a bit warmer. Now, what I've done is remove any defaults I have from the camera import. So I have Lightroom set up to automatically pick up some metadata and use that to apply things to the photo, and I'll talk you through that separately later. So what you can see here in the history panel is that I've removed any defaults and gone to the Adobe defaults, and it's looking quite a bit warmer. If I zoom in and look at the swallow here, and then compare that to the same zoomed in view on Sony Image Editor, you can see there's quite a bit of difference between the two. The sort of bluey purple colours around the swallow's head look more black here. The whites of the cloud look a sort of yellow colour. And the orange of the beak is duller than the Sony version. So there's quite a difference there. So now I'm going to take that RAW file into Luminar Neo. So here it is in Neo. And I would say the colours are probably similar to the Sony version, but maybe a bit flatter. We look at the zoomed in version, it's definitely less vibrant than either the Lightroom or Sony versions. And overall, there's less contrast in the colours. The blue is probably similar in the sky to the Sony, but again, not quite as vibrant. So next, I'm going to take that RAW file into Topaz Denoise, and I'm going to put it straight into Topaz Denoise, not using Denoise as a plugin to something else. So the RAW file goes straight into that package. So here's the RAW file conversion in Topaz Denoise. And I think the colours are probably similar to the Sony version, but overall the photo is a little bit darker. We look at the bird zoomed in. Those darks just look a little bit darker than they do in the other packages. So now I'm going to save each of these four photos out of the four different pieces of software with no editing changes whatsoever to any of them, so that you can compare them all. And I think you'll agree here that there are some significant differences between the way that each package has converted that raw file into a viewable image. And so your starting point for editing is always going to be different depending on which piece of software you've chosen. Now, if you do this experiment for yourself, you'll probably find that many files look similar. They're not going to be exactly the same. But say you put 20 different files through a number of different pieces of software, you'd probably find that over half of them are fairly similar, but will have noticeable differences. There'll probably be three or four of them that are fairly different, and you'll probably find another three or four that are significantly different. And so a lot of this does depend upon which software you're using. So what else is in a RAW file? Well, a RAW file will contain a lot of metadata. All of the information that your camera uses to take a photo can be written back to the RAW file. So anything you choose to do in camera, anything that's hidden in the menus of your camera that you use as you're taking your photo, pretty much all written back to the RAW file. So things like white balance, aspect ratio, color profiles, and all sorts of other stuff is written back. And some of that info can be used by the software to automatically do things for you if you know how to do it. So if I go out and in a day, for example, I might take 300 photos and I get back home and maybe I want to edit 80 of those photos. Well, I don't want to be messing around with the white balance, the aspect ratio, and the color profile for 80 different photos. So I can set Lightroom up to automatically pick up that information and apply it. Now, different software will do that in different ways. Some software doesn't give you the choice and will automatically pick up anything that you've used. Some software may not pick it up at all, but lots of software has a way to pick up that information and apply it. So I'm going to show you here how to set that up in Lightroom. But if you're using something different, have a look on the website of that software and figure out how to do it. So I'll show you how to set up Lightroom to automatically use the camera settings that you used in your camera when you import a RAW file. So you go to Edit and then down to Preferences, and in the dialog box that pops up, you want to go to the Presets tab and then look for this global dropdown. Now you've got three options here. You've got Adobe Default, which will give you Adobe's default settings. You've got Camera Settings, which uses all the things you used in camera, like a color profile, an aspect ratio, a custom white balance, for example. Or you've got the option to apply a preset by default. So I have mine set to camera settings so that it picks up all the things I did in camera and gives me a RAW file conversion that is as close to the picture that I took in camera as possible. And that saves me loads of time. But there's also all sorts of other information that's captured in your RAW file. One of the most useful ones is the shutter count. So if you ever come to sell your camera and you take it to a dealership for them to buy it, you'll take it into the shop and they will inspect it and give you a price. And one of the first things they do on that inspection is they will take a photograph and upload it to a website that can output all of the metadata for that file. And within the metadata, it contains the latest shutter count. So that will tell the dealer how many times the mechanical shutter in that camera has been used, and they will use that as the basis of the price they give you. They'll factor other things in, of course, but the most likely thing to fail in your camera is the mechanical shutter. Whether you're using a mirrorless camera or a DSLR, they both have mechanical shutters, and it's the most likely thing to fail first. So that shutter count gives them a good indication of what price they should be offering. But there is all sorts of other information. So there are websites out there that can read that metadata and you can search for them and upload a file and see what you get. And it will vary from one RAW file format to another. But I'm going to give you an example here of a website reading one of my RAW files. So there are a few options out there for reading metadata from RAW files. And if you search on Google, you'll find quite a few. But in this case, I'm using metadata2go.com. So let's just grab a raw file and we'll drop one in there. So just uploading it now, and in a few moments we'll get the results and I'll talk you through some of the things that you can see. Okay, so here's the metadata from the raw file I uploaded, and there's all sorts of stuff. You can see the file name, the type of raw file, the camera that was used. I've added in my name in the camera, so that automatically writes to the raw file who took it. And there's all sorts of other useful information as we go down. So let's have a look at some of it. So we can see here that I'm using an uncompressed 14-bit raw file. We can see the dimensions of the raw file, the date and time the photo was taken. Here we can see the focal length that I was using at the time. So I was using my zoom lens at 467 millimeters. And here we've got what's called the creative style in the raw file data. That's what's referred to commonly as a picture profile. And I made a video on picture profiles before. So this information writes back to the raw file and your photo editing software can use it. What else have we got here? So you can see I was using cloudy white balance. You can see the lens that I used, my Sony 200-600. I was in autofocus continuous mode. Now, here's an interesting one that you probably don't realize gets recorded in there. Not useful for photo editing, but it can still be useful. You've got the ambient temperature that was recorded at 15 degrees centigrade. And you've got the camera temperature at 23 degrees centigrade. So that's all right. You expect the camera to be a little bit warmer because it's an electronic piece of equipment. But if you can see that that is significantly higher than the ambient temperature, you know that your camera is often overheating. So it's a good one to look at. Similarly here with the battery temperature. You can see I use no flash for this photo, but if you sometimes use flash, it will record there how you used it. We've got the shutter count here. Now, this is an interesting one. It counts each and every time you use that mechanical shutter. And then here we can see a whole few rows of information about how your white balance has been affected. So if you've picked one of the non-auto white balance modes, or you have done a custom white balance, that is all written back and your photo editing software can pick it up and use it. And here's another interesting one. So it's got the focus distance. Now, this is the focus distance as recorded by your camera. I'm never sure how accurate this is, but it's not going to be a million miles off, even if it's inaccurate. And it gives you an idea of how far you were from the thing that you were focusing on. So in this case, I was a fraction over 7 meters away from the bird. And here's another one. We've got the CFA pattern. So this is the pattern of photo sites in your sensor. So by looking at this red, green, green, blue matrix, the photo editing software knows that I've got a Bayer filter. If it had got a different arrangement in there, it might know, for example, that it's an X-trans filter. So there's all sorts of useful information here that gets appended to the raw file and which your photo editing software can use automatically if you set it up correctly. So now you can see the plethora of data that's contained in those raw files. There's one important tip that comes out of that that every photographer, particularly mirrorless camera photographers, should know. And that is keep your shutter count down. So there are times, even with mirrorless, when we have to use the mechanical shutter, if you're using a flash, for example. But also other times it's really useful, like low light, for example. Your mirrorless camera will cope better in low light situations using the mechanical shutter than it will using the electronic one. But if you can keep the mechanical shutter count down, you'll maximize the value that you get for your camera when you come to sell it. So let's have a look at that file that I put into the metadata reader. So if I grab that and we'll bring that into Lightroom. So in the library module here, you're looking at the JPEG preview that's embedded in the raw file. But if we move over to the develop module, you're looking at the raw file conversion, but based upon those camera settings you selected. So if, for example, I look here, it's automatically picked up that I've used the color profile of camera portrait. So if I don't like that, I can just click in the four little boxes here and go and click Adobe Standard to see what that would look like. Now you can see there the colours are slightly different. And likewise, we've got white balance as shot. So it's picked up the white balance settings I chose in camera. But if I don't like that, I can take that off and just put it back onto auto. So there we can see that's ever so slightly different from what I picked in camera. Now, if I go back to the original, that's what I had in camera, or as close as to what I had in camera as possible. This is the Adobe default. So slightly different colours, and I like what I did in camera a lot more, so I'm going to leave it at that. Now, let's have a look for another photo, one where I've changed the aspect ratio in camera. So here you can see a woodland scene, and you can see that in camera I chose a square crop or 1:1 aspect ratio. So if I bring that over into Lightroom. So again, here you're looking at the JPEG preview that's embedded in the RAW file, but this JPEG preview is based upon the full size picture before I applied that aspect ratio in camera. If I head over to the develop module, you can see that automatically it has picked up that aspect ratio that I used in camera. Now, if I go to the crop tool, it will allow me to go back to the original aspect ratio if I want to, or choose any other. And I think actually that when I edited this photo, I went for a 4:3 as the final image and did something like that. But if you are mostly getting it right in camera, getting the image looking how you want it to in camera, this kind of thing can save you loads of time in photo editing. Now, although that saves me a lot of time, remember that any interpretation that that software makes of, for example, the white balance won't be exactly the same as the interpretation that another piece of software will make. So just like no two RAW file conversions are the same, no two applications of your metadata will be the same. Now, one other important point to note about RAW files is that they can capture light information that's a little bit outside the range of the histogram. Now, if you don't know what the histogram is, it's something that you can see in camera if you're using a mirrorless camera or if you're in the live view mode of your DSLR. You can also look at it when you review pictures in the playback mode, and you can look at it in the photo editing software that you use. And it gives you the range of light from pure white to pure black, broken down into 256 levels. Now, RAW files can bring you whites that are slightly brighter than the white end of the histogram, and blacks that are slightly darker than the black end of the histogram. And one of the things that I often get asked when I'm teaching about the histogram is, why don't cameras show the RAW file information in the histogram rather than the JPEG? Because it's a really good question. If you're able to capture data, image, information that's slightly outside that range, why doesn't it show you the exact range that you can capture? And there's a very good reason for that. And the reason is that the RAW file is just unprocessed image data. Yes, back to that phrase again. So the histogram counts the number of pixels at each of those 256 levels and makes a graph out of it. But because a RAW file isn't yet an image, and remember, pixels don't come into it till you get to an image. On your camera, in your sensor, they're photo sites, they're not pixels. So we can't count the pixels until a RAW file conversion has happened. And so what you're seeing in your camera is what would happen if that image was saved directly there and then as a JPEG. And that means that the RAW file can capture whites that are slightly brighter than the edge of the histogram and blacks that are slightly darker than the other edge of the histogram. And that's important to note because you'll never quite know exactly how far you can push it. But the more you get used to your camera, you'll start to get a sense of how far beyond the edge of that histogram you can take things. So one of the things that makes our RAW files more editable is the type of file that they are. So RAW files are all either 12-bit or 14-bit files, whereas JPEGs, which is typically the format we save our final images in, are just 8-bit files. So that means you can capture 8 bits of information per pixel or photo site per color channel, which gives you a total of 256 pieces of information or levels of colour per pixel. Whereas 12-bit files can capture 16 times as many colours as that. And we're going to cover that a lot more in part 2 when we look at other file formats. And for that, you want to click here. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you on the next video.